flag, the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
If you'd all stand, remain standing for a moment of silence for the sick, handicapped, departed, and the military personnel of our community. Thank you.
Councilmember Jackson, Bruce Valdez.
Here.
Bill Henderson.
Here.
Bill Ryan.
Here.
Joe Flossom.
Here.
Joe DiGucci.
Here.
Bert Cherry.
Here.
Pat DeLazio.
Here.
Tom Vernon.
Here.
Joe Sykes.
Here.
Cory Collins.
Here.
Chad King.
Here.
Bill Chilio.
Here.
And Dan Miller.
Yes, Mary.
Here I am again. Thank you very much. I'll try not to take more than 5 minutes of your time. Right now, I am representing the Bridgeville Area Historical Society. Our drawing tomorrow for the Penguin tickets is around 1 o'clock, and you have until 1 o'clock tomorrow to come and buy tickets if you wish. It will get you 2 seats to next Sunday's afternoon Penguin game. Secondly, we already have, and I left them here last week, I have no idea what happened to them. We already have 4 programs slated. The next one sounds very, these are held at our fire hall at 7:30 at night. The one at the end of this month is a robbery at a bank in Castle Shannon. I have no idea what that's all about, but that's the title. Then we're very fortunate at the end of April, we're having a program about Roberto Clemente, which I hope is very successful. Then in May, we'll be Civil War, the young man who wrote the book about what all he found in his family attic. So really good programs. They start at 7:30. They're free and open to the public. They're down at the fire hall. The daily savings time. Come on down. And tomorrow night, if it does not snow, we're back to the second Tuesday night program. Of all things, we're trying to redesign the way Washington Avenue was in the 1940s. Very, very interesting. But you're all welcome to come to those tomorrow night at 7 o'clock over at 441 Station Street. At this moment, I'm changing. I'm going to represent myself, some of the feelings I have about our community. About 8 or 10 years ago, during a snowstorm, the borough came and got me in a truck, and we came down here and met with PennDOT. The PennDOT man assured me, quote, then in 4 to 6 years, the interchange would be started up at Boyce Road, up at that area, taking some of the traffic congestion then out of Bridgeville. As you well know, that never happened. So one of the things I'm recommending, and they come a little strong for an old lady, but that's okay. That would be to put pressure on PennDOT to do something about that interchange. Start correcting, don't do Band-Aid, whatever, road work. Get to the main problem, get it taken care of, and as things will start to even out to some degree. Certainly, they could do a double-decker from Upper Sinclair near the rec center all the way across to 519, to 79 onto the new highway, which they assure me is going to start in 3 or 4 years. We'll see. Anyway, these are ideas when you can't sleep at 5 o'clock in the morning, go through your head. Another one, I saw some of the information in the news media about the house and the kid got locked out and what the police found. And I just recommend to this organization, review the ordinance on absentee landlords. I don't know if that was an issue in this event, but we've had trouble with it in the past, I ought to know. And I just urge you to be more strict, if at all possible, of these absentee landlords. And the last thing, a long time ago, I'll turn your memory back about 10 years, we, the parking authority, decided to have free parking from 6 p.m. on. Great. Except the people who were there 9 to 5 paid the bills. And so I'm urging you people, the parking authority, to consider two-hour free parking during the daytime for the people who have helped pay for this all along. If that's not it, then I'll settle for one. I don't want to. But they, people who come to eat, get dinner, get lunch, whatever, they need the same break as the people who go to work or go to eat and drink after 6 p.m. Thank you for listening. I told you I'd keep it short. Hope to see you tomorrow night. Thanks.
Thank you, ma'am.
Oh, I did that before, too.
Eugene?
Hi, my name is Eugene Maslott. We live on 1264 Terrace Street. I have a problem with my property from Short Street to drainage up there. I know they put one drainage in many years ago. And facing my house from Short Street, that was on the right-hand side up one.
You're on the corner, right?
Not on the corner,
like
just before the corner.
Second one down, yeah.
Yeah. I'm having problems with water coming over top my property and coming down on the left side where I put up the wall years ago, railroad ties. As they're getting really bad, rotting out, and their wall's like almost ready to fall over. And there's mud leaking through now, and I'm afraid that it's going to, if it falls, it's going to get into the street, Terrace Street. I don't know how you guys work things or whatever, so I'm just going to say this, that we don't have the funds to put up a new, we'll take it down, put a new wall up, or labor, because I got bad knees, of course, I'm handicapped, I don't know how to go about this. If you could have somebody come up and take a look at it, and maybe make a diagnosis of it.
You know, Public Works come up,
because
we're not aware of it.
Yeah.
So
we'll find out where the water's coming from.
Right. Right. So we'll have Public Works come up, and Joe and I can take a ride up too.
Yeah. I mean,
take a look at it and see where it's coming from.
Is it possible that they could fund the project?
It depends upon whether it's a public issue or not.
Right.
Yeah,
if it's coming from the alley up there. Yeah, maybe a storm drain needed up there or something like that. So we'll take a look at that. As far as funding something on private property, we can't do that. But we can rectify the problem as far as, you know, find out where the money's coming.
Okay, what am I going to have to do with that while he's done on when he's out in the street?
Let's come look at it first.
Okay.
Let's not jump to conclusions.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, we'll look at it and then, if you can give me your phone number,
sure.
And I will
Okay, 412-221-1195.
We'll call you before we come.
Okay.
And that way we can use it.
Okay.
Okay.
Prior to that, I work.
Okay.
Just one day, so, okay.
Okay.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
Okay. Anybody else have anything to say, or before we move in?
No.
Okay, we'll move on. I need a motion of Borough Council regarding the minutes of February 13th, 2017 regular meeting as submitted.
So moved.
I'll second it. We have a first and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Yes. Ayes have it. The 2017 pavement maintenance program. Motion of the Borough Council authorizing engineer sites to prepare bid documentation and manager Collins to advertise the same for the 2017 Borough Paving Maintenance Program. The following streets are included in this 2017 program. Shady Avenue from Murray Avenue to Station Street. Cook School Road from Main Street to Bar Hill Road, which The water company is partnering with us because they've gone through and put new water lines in and out. They'll cover 50% of the costs, will be covered by them. Silva Street from Bar Hill Road to Main Street, that also will be partnered with the Pittsburgh Water Company. Main Street from Coke School Road to Pezzavento, that'll also be a partnership. Spruce Street from McLaughlin Run Road to Laurel Street. We need a motion to authorize them to move forward.
So moved.
Joe? Second?
Question?
Question?
Joe, there is a short part of New York Street that the water company also worked on. Are they paving the entire street? Or should we look at 50% on that?
I'll have to look into that, Pat, because I wasn't aware that they did work up on New York Street.
Yeah.
So I'll take a look at it and then see what we can do. It depends on which contractor, if it's Colosimo, we'll partner with them. If it's Golden Triangle may be what they did on Margaret Street. They just went ahead and did.
That's why I was.
With the Margaret Street on their own, so I gotta find out.
It's Golden Triangle.
Okay. We can get in contact with somebody. Okay, we'll take a look at it, Pat.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Against? Ayes have it. Bill list, a motion by Borough Council regarding the March 17th bill list.
I'll move.
Second. We have a first and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Against? Motion for payroll. A motion of Borough Council approving the payroll of March 17th, 24th, 31st, April 7th of 2017. We have a motion.
I'll second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Against? Monthly reports. Motion to accept and pay all commissions due to February of 2017 real estate tax collector's report.
I'll move.
Second?
Second.
Bert? All in favor?
Aye.
Against? Ayes have it. A motion to accept the January 2017 financial report.
I'll move.
Joe?
Second?
Second.
Bert? All in favor?
Aye.
Against? Ayes have it. A motion to accept the February 2017 police report.
So moved.
Second.
Joe? All in favor?
Aye.
Against? Ayes have it. A motion to accept the February 2017 zoning report.
So moved.
Joe? Second?
Second.
Joe? All in favor?
Aye.
Against? Ayes have it. Committee reports, administration, which follows on me, I have no report. Joe Verducci, finance?
We've been talking about a lot of the different finances. One of the things that we have really liked to concentrate on for the next few months is there is a significant amount of real estate taxes that are outstanding in 2016, as well as there are some still due for previous years also. So Lori has advised me that we're going to start making some phone calls, start sending some letters, and taking action. Something that we need to address and to help our cash flow as well as the finances in the future. Other than that, I think things are going well. We just need to move forward with something like that.
Thanks, Joe. Anybody have questions for Joe?
This may be a good opportunity to talk about, I think it's 146 Terrett Liberty.
Yes, 146
Liberty. I don't know if they're behind on their borough taxes. I'm going to think that they're not.
No, they're not.
They're just behind on their county taxes.
They're not.
So they don't pay the county, but they pay us.
Well, on my list.
Jesus. That is amazing. So they're paying and letting people just
okay.
Because you know where I'm going. When we have abandoned properties like this, mm-hmm. to get them sheriff sale and move forward.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they're
I believe they're up to date with their sewage and garbage too. The owners live in South Carolina, and they, we've had contact with them before with other properties that they've owned. And they do keep up with the bills.
I mean, from the county website, they're not keeping up with the county. Maybe we can get them to foreclose. That was it, thank you.
Parks and Recreation, Joe Glossom.
Thanks, Bruce. Over the past month, on the nice weather days, parks folks have been down the parks cleaning up fallen branches or whatnot. And they did some weeding, spraying the weed along the fences last week. I was down in the park and I was talking to Lori about it. The guardrail along the, coming down the hill by the creek is really washed away. The guardrail's hanging there basically, so Public Works is going to take the guardrail out and put more Jersey barriers in, but that's going to need addressed, I think. Maybe some riprap down there or something, but I think we're on that pretty much. Lori had me and the fellow Public Works people was program about non-smoking and not smoking in the parks. This comes up every few years. I remember my last time I was on council, it came up, and for some reason it didn't fly, whether people were complaining about not being able to smoke in the parks or whatever. But I think it's a good idea how you enforce something like that. I don't know. But I'll talk it over with my fellow committee people on Public Works and see what they think. Maybe to get an ordinance on the books and put some signs up, no smoking.
I think that might help.
Basically, the kids are down there playing ball and they shouldn't be smoke or whatever. I remember back in the day when it was 30 years ago, I used to manage and whatnot, the guys would be smoking right on the darn bench. So it was like things have changed somewhat.
Correct me if I'm wrong when I read these signs that this program will provide.
They'll provide the signs.
Yeah, it's all free.
Everything's free. It's throughout the income.
Do we have to make a motion or anything?
You can make a motion to authorize us to, the ordinance is prepared to authorize us to advertise the ordinance if you wanted to move forward.
Is that what you were looking to do?
I'm all for it, yeah, but if you want to go ahead and do it, I'd say fine, go ahead and do it then.
I'll second.
How do you want this spelled out?
Motion to advertise a no smoking policy in the borough parks.
Okay.
No smoking ordinance.
To advertise it?
Yeah, to advertise it, we have to advertise it.
Is your park policy in the form of an ordinance? Or is it a park policy?
It's just a park policy.
I mean, if you wanted to have it enforceable by citation, it has to be an ordinance, otherwise that's your property. You can also do it by resolution. I don't know how you do your general park rules at the top of my head.
I think we have general rules. I'm trying to think.
But we can look, if you give me authorization, then
yeah.
Any necessary ordinance or?
Yeah, there's a sample ordinance in there, so it's a kind of don't look like
right.
That.
Yeah.
So.
We have a motion and a second. Floor is
second.
Seconds. All in favor?
Aye.
Against? Ayes have.
That's all I ask.
Bruce, one other thing. I saw the BAA folks at the bingo fundraiser on Sunday. They have their annual cleanup day of the park on March 26th, starting between 9 and 10 o'clock, and then they'll probably work for a few hours, you know, just doing all the cleanup that they normally do at the beginning of the. Lori, did they call you about the water?
No, they haven't.
Did you have to go call Jeremy?
Yeah, I have to call Jeremy. Illinois. We have to call Illinois because
of water. That's good. Okay. Thanks, Joe. Public Works at Buildings, that's my department. Public Works, I just want to say welcome Bill Blatt back. He was off for about 3 months after an operation that he came back March 6th, and we're back to full crew. Do you want to give anything on Buildings?
Lori had Sherwin-Williams come and prepare a specification for
recovering the roof out here. We're going to use our own manpower with their specification and purchase the material directly. Just waiting for good weather on that. We're still playing around with letters for this wall. We've gotten some samples in. I think we're going to have to go to something darker. I'll take care of that.
Thank you. Public safety?
Yeah, I have just a couple of things. First, Chief has advised me through a couple of part-timers finding full-time work outside of the borough. And one of our other officers is going to be off injured for a significant time. We're in need of a part-time officer, so he's in the process of seeking a qualified force to help us in this time of need. The other thing, I just wanted to comment and appreciate the police department's use of social media. It has really, at times it's entertaining, but I would say that it's also very informative, and it has allowed the community to stay in touch with some of the things that are going on. And I appreciate it, and I've heard from a number of residents that appreciate it.
Yeah, I was actually going to say the same thing. Yeah. It's been great. I've heard that from a lot of people, a lot of my neighbors, a lot of people in the town.
Good.
So appreciate that.
Thank you.
That's all I have. Okay, thank you. Mayor, do you have anything to say, sir?
Let's see. We've handled 140, we're talking here about 146 Terror, Liberty. Is this a good time to talk about parking or?
Well, I actually have it in the.
Parking is where.
Is the parking.
In the agenda, line item for the parking board, no additional talk.
No additional report.
Thank you, sir. Police Chief.
Chad King. Thank you, Councilman Gallarducci. In regards to the 146 Liberty Street, if anybody has any questions, I can answer them now, but it was pretty much explained in the media last week. Just as an update, the individuals, Mrs. Rittmeyer and Mr. Stancic, had their preliminary hearings today at court, and the charges for child endangerment were actually upgraded to felonies, and the charges were all held for court. However, as part of that deal, the judge did let them out of jail on their own recognizance. So they are back out, but the charges were held and upgraded to felonies.
Anybody have any questions for the chief? Okay. Solicitor Tom McDermott?
I have nothing in addition to my report.
Okay. Engineer Joe Sykes?
Thank you. We've covered the CCTV about the contract here in front of me. I'll get in contact with AAA Flexible Pipe, and we'll get a construction meeting scheduled with them. And then we also have the contracts executed with Solar Construction. Anticipate a start here within the next 2 weeks on the sanitary sewer plant repairs. The 2017 pavement maintenance, thank you for making the motion to prepare the road program. We'll get that advertised so we can open bids prior to the April meeting and make an award at that time. Bower Hill Road, we'll get back to People's Gas and Tia Robinson to get the restoration work started there during the spring. McLaughlin Park Phase 2, the documents are to the DCNR for review, and once they get them back to us, we'll place it out for bid. The Washington and James Development, the manager and I met with the architect about 2 weeks ago to discuss their submission for approval. Their design will not be submitted until the borough design standards are finalized and approved. And on a side note, we had another call from the one that may just try to blend everything in with what the existing architecture is of the borough, not have the need for the design standards. So
they're going back and forth.
I
spoke to one of their new project folks too, and that's where they've been between,
right.
Well, I mean, and the contractor that's working with the architect. So they, the new team is kind of wondering why are we going to see this? So they may just.
Sure. And then the Chartier Street, Washington Avenue, and Chartier's Bridge intersection. They had that project status meeting with Pendle on January 26th, and they're working on the design. So that's all I have.
Okay. Thank you, Joe.
Yeah. While we were on that, we read in your report, Lori, we sent another letter relative to the fencing down there.
Yes.
At this point, let's do something. I mean, he's been given enough time. If he's not playing by our rules now, I don't want to see him.
Yeah, I had conversations with he's working with a new gentleman, a new developer, and I had conversations with him to that regard, as far as council has requested, and then I had the code enforcement officer send him a notification. He was stating that he felt that it was a liability because people were throwing glass bottles in the fencing, but as Tom and I talked about, they're probably throwing glass bottles in because
it's fencing, yeah.
And I had even told him that.
Three quarters per can.
Yeah, that when our public works crews are out twice a week picking up garbage, if he takes the fence down and they happen to see something in that lot, they'll pick it up. And that, you know, we wanted to work with him and are getting the feeling that, you know, we want to have a smooth project, and him not complying is not making this very smooth, so he is headed to the magistrate now.
Tom, you don't see any increased liability?
No, none.
Okay.
No, we communicated that too. They have different reasons to short, and we communicate, I communicated to the lawyer the same frustrations that Lori did to the other.
And I think that everybody understands in his team except for him.
Okay.
So.
Thank you. Okay.
If I might, and I realize that you're going back and forth with him, but he really should come to the next planning commission meeting. And if he doesn't come to that, he should come to the next council meeting so that he hears what we're saying. And I know you're communicating it.
It's been 5 or 6 months in a row that we've requested to get that fence down.
He has an official notice of violation of the process to appeal. And he's had several emails. His architect has been told and communicated to him, but his developer has been told. So,
yeah, my reason for asking him is not about the fence. My reason for trying to get him here is so that he can both tell us what he's looking for, hear what we're looking for, and move forward.
Well, he knows what.
We're waiting. There's nothing really, if I might interject.
Okay, then.
A, we don't want to bring him to council level on the enforcement action. That's where it should be at administrative level and is in process. On the other thing, they're actually, they're all in their court. They're actually right now, and we're waiting for them, based on my last conversation with their one team leader, the person who works with them, they're going to get back with us when they decide what they wish to do. There's really nothing for them to come to the planning commission to talk about, or even us. We don't have anything for us.
And Joe and I had a lengthy meeting with their architect, going over
all of
our code, conditional use, every step, what needs to be done next. They understand and they know everything that needs to be done. Their dilemma is what they want to do, if they want to wait for the draft design standards, or if they want to come in under our standards that exist now, and they're trying to decide whether they want to build a glass building or if it may be cost prohibitive. They're finding that to be the problem now. So it's really them trying to decide what they want to present, because right now they're unsure.
Right, and it seems that even between the time of their meeting and my conversation, they've changed horses on their primary contractor, the person.
They have, yes.
And that person is reassessing
yes.
what he thinks is best to take back to the owner.
Mm-hmm. A certain reality is starting to come.
Just another perspective from their project management team.
And I even offered to, you know, you guys get a site plan put together, be more than glad to look at it on an unofficial basis to give you some feedback, so that when you make the official submission, we've got things in order.
Right. So we've done everything we can.
We've reached out.
Okay. For your audience information, the property we were talking about is across the street from the library, the post office. Where they tore the house down, the building and that down, and they filled it back in and put the fence around it. We've been trying to get them to remove the fence so it doesn't look like it's junked up there. So that's what we're discussing at this time. Anything else?
No.
Okay.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Fire Chief Bill Chiller.
Thanks, Mr. President. Just a couple things real quick. One, thanks to everybody 2 weeks ago for coming down for the fish fry. We sold out. Keep it going. We got another one this week. Doing good. The only other thing I got is we had an incident a couple weeks ago up on Terrace of a person cleaning a motorcycle in his basement that the gas tank was leaking and tore the engine apart and flushed everything down the sewer. He thought there was nothing wrong with doing that, but he put the fumes into 8 houses that we had to attend to that night till we found the source. Lori will be getting the pictures and my reports this week, just finished up getting the pictures put over. But we have pictures and all this, but he literally, I didn't see nothing wrong with doing this. I talked to the 8 residents that were pushed out of their house that weren't too happy. The odor was that strong.
We actually called.
Yeah.
We were the ones that called.
Yeah, so, you know, my emphasis to everybody is please don't wash things down the source. I mean, I can't emphasize it more than that, it's easy. But, yeah, he tore his motorcycle apart right on top of the sewer line, the sewer gear in the house.
Spasm dumping oil down the source.
Yeah, well, that went down too. Because he broke the motor, got pictures of the motor all broken down.
Well, the people used to go out to the curb and dump it in.
Yeah.
Storm source, so.
So, that's all I thought about the person.
Okay, thank you. Dan Miller's not here. Is there anybody from the public library, Bridgeville Library, delegate? Parking authority delegate.
Well, you know, people know I've been on the parking authority a long time. And this is my, you don't want to do this. I'm an old man.
We can't hear you from back there.
All right. This is our first invitation. And I said, you know, we must be doing something really good and get invited anyone to our secrets. So I want to know what we do with our in our little secret club. As everybody knows, a couple years ago we did Lot 1 and redid that one. We did 4 down on Railroad. We just talked to Joe and we're going to looking at revamping 2 to make it more user friendly. And because of the cracking of the asphalt, I was there when we put the lot in, and it seemed maybe only yesterday, but it's been on 25 years, and the asphalt's sinking, so we need to address that. So that's our goal.
Which one is Lot 2?
Lot 2 is a tar block building crossing Bergs, Armstrong's. Lot 4 is the Railroad Avenue deal. We put cameras in to protect our customer and their cars. And we hope that the police can use them to enhance their job a little bit because we can't impede on private residents, but we can look at the general lot. I don't want to say, biggest thing is we have about 4,500 to 6,500 customers a month use our lots, and that takes a lot of maintenance. We, as you know, the public works is out there getting ready for tonight, and our guys are all reloaded, got your trucks, it's on with the gas station filling up, so they're ready for 5 o'clock in the morning, so the parking lots are all paved, you know, plowed and salted, and so that takes money. We try to work on the landscape, make them more beautiful. And Bert started it, well, how many years ago? 20 years ago?
Yeah.
On Lot 1, showing us how a little bit of foliage makes a whole better picture. And this is what we turned it into. You saw what we did on 4. And we have a guy, it takes him almost once or twice a week to go and make these places stay pretty. And the weeds come out. I don't want to say what else you want to know. The biggest thing we're proud of as a parking authority is the banner program. We started the banner program. The extra money that's raised, it goes to either wounded warriors or one of the military donations. Our secret is the people you give me, they're frugal. I won't say they're cheap, but they're frugal. They watch their pennies. And so we don't spend, it takes a little while to get things going. I know it took, what did you start, your original thing was 20 years ago, it took us 10 years to get that lot done. And Joe knows that 4 took us a couple of years, Our goal for two is the spring of 18. Depends what, how the bids come down and what Joe comes up with. Because we, things have changed since we put that lot in. We have big trucks, we can't, that have to service the merchants there, and they're tearing up the sidewalks on Janeway. So we're gonna, Joe and I have looked at it. He's come up with some ideas how to make the entrances better so 18-wheelers and bigger trucks can get in and out of there, service the merchants around Tarbox Building and Rankin Building. So that's our whole spiel. We're not a secret. The only one that really finds us is Frank and Pat. The rest of us don't know we exist. We get our meetings done in 15 to 20 minutes and we're gone. We pay our bills and we just don't want to become a line item on your budget. That's our biggest thing. So we're very frugal in what we do with our money. And thank you for your time.
I do have a question for you.
Yeah.
Mike and I had stopped and spoken with you prior to the last meeting. Is there any information you were able to gather on the potential two-hour parking?
We're looking into the costs. I can't guarantee you anything at this point. Looking at our long-term, what Joe comes up with on costs to put this lot in, what we have in the bank. We don't want to be broke. You know, it costs us $10,000 to $12,000 a month to run these lots.
No, I understand that. And I'm going to be very clear when I say this. I'm not saying anything negative about what's going on here. We've been asked this question numerous times. That's why Mike and I had requested it. And one of the other issues that a lot of people have had here over the last 6 months, 10 months, was the abrupt raise in the prices of parking and tickets. So it's kind of tough for me when I have to explain to everybody what's going on and what's happening when you're saying being frugal, but at the same time, our price went up X amount. Mm-hmm. And the one thing we've been asked for the most, you're saying you're not sure you can get the information?
Well, we're getting it together. The pay station was a big going forward. It was brought to our attention, I don't know, Frank, what, 6 months ago, 8 months ago? You thought that'd be a great idea?
I thought it would be an enhancement, some means of paying other than quarters. Yeah.
Yeah. So it's a work in progress. We haven't discarded it, but we also are responsible for paying our bills, and that's our goal at this point.
Okay. So is there going to be a point at all where we're going to get this information?
By the time we see what the lot costs and what we have and project what we can take in, because it costs. All right. Anything else?
Anybody else have any questions for me?
I'm just kind of curious. What was your question? I'm trying to figure out where you
were. Well, we had the parking authority meeting last meeting, okay. Mike Homer and myself, and the request we had was we've had a ton of people, including a lot of businesses in the borough, asking for two-hour free parking.
Okay.
So we say, hey, that could work, that couldn't work. We don't know for sure. You guys are the ones that have the numbers and know what you're spending and what it would take to kind of police that type of a scenario.
Right.
And that's what I wish Mike was here, but I'm pretty sure that's what we're both thinking. We would have some sort of information like that at this meeting. I mean, that was our reasoning and asking for it. I want to be clear. No one here, myself included, is saying anything bad. We're just getting asked for this information, so we have to have something to say back to the public when it's coming to us.
Am I allowed to ask a question? I guess for the council.
Good.
Are you folks getting feedback from the people in the community? Are they reaching out to the council members regarding some of the frustrations that the people are experiencing with the new parking, the rate, and then beyond the rate, then when they didn't introduce the pay stations? The challenges that people are experiencing with the pay station.
Absolutely.
I'm just curious where the council is and how knowledgeable you are if people are coming to you. Because as a business owner, I'm feeling it every single day.
Sure. And there's quite a few recorded comments in the minutes over the last however long it's been here with people coming in and voicing the concerns about those exact same things, and that's why we've asked the question. That's all there is to it. Yeah, citizens ask for something. We have to do our due diligence, see if we can figure it out. And go from there.
Can I interject another? Is the council aware that it was brought to my attention? We have taken it to the parking authority. I don't know where they've gone with it, but we've had some handicapped people that have come into our operation, and handicapped people can't access the pay stations. And they brought that up as a concern. There's no access to a pay station if I'm a handicapped individual in a wheelchair. Or I can't, there's no access to at least two of them that I know of. I don't know if there's access to the third one that was split up, as far as the pay station is concerned. And I am aware that the city of Pittsburgh got a lot of heat when they introduced their pay stations in the city, and they spent a lot of money to address that because of the way their pay stations were set up, and handicapped individuals weren't able to get to the pay station. One of the things that the parking authority, Mike, you'd have to remind me if it was November, December to me, where this was brought up again regarding the handicap, and it was agreed upon, I believe, if I'm not mistaken, by the parking authority, that they were going to let handicapped individuals, people parking in the handicapped spots, have free parking. And the question was, how are they going to know that? And there were supposed to be some signs there. I have not seen any signs on any of those handicapped spots yet. Do we know if that's taken place?
As soon as the weather breaks, right, then we'll get all that stuff in. But part of the redevelopment of parking lot too is addressing the curbs, addressing sidewalk accesses. And this all, hopefully when Joe comes back with a final drawing of what, or rendering of what he thinks we should do, it'll be all compatible and be up to code.
Certainly, we can run into a more of a serious problem if they get the ADA or whoever that organization is involved, you know, to handicap people. But I'm not throwing that up, I'm just saying that.
If they got free handicap parking, the people parking in the handicaps.
They don't know about it, that's the challenge.
I'm just, once the signage is up, that'll take care of
it. We all supported that. Okay, yeah. Put signs up so they know they don't have to go to a pay station, but we still don't have that access. And I don't know, you're familiar, the frustration that people bring to you on the pay stations. You know, you have to, if it's like tomorrow morning, if anybody's going in there to pay, and it's 15 degrees, you have to take your gloves off to activate it, to do all the work you're doing. If you're not quick enough, you're going to spend a lot more time if that's an issue with the pay station. I'm not sure if the council's familiar with some of those challenges. And it's losing connections quite often.
I do want to bring something up about that. We did talk about this often. People brought it up. And when I spoke to the parking commission, it was kind of brought to my attention that that was a real big desire of the business owners to have the pay stations versus.
Exactly. An alternative to pay other than having quarters all the time. So that's where the credit card and the pay stations. We're all supportive of the pay stations. We're questioning the quality of the pay stations. One of the fixes coming with the, one of the fixes that they discussed was the introduction of a free app. That, you know, many of the townships around here, Carnegie has one, Dormont has one, the city of Pittsburgh uses one. I know I was not at the February Parking Authority meeting, I was at the January Parking Authority meeting. And they had a gentleman that was there that said, we're this close to approving the free app, that people can put the app on the phone. That way they can do it from inside their car, they can do it from inside a restaurant, they can do it from wherever they're at, so that they don't have to deal with the pay station, especially in the climate weather. And I'd be curious what the status of
Frank, that is approved.
The app.
And it's in the Lord, in Bryn Love's hands.
It was in there, his hands in January too, that's why I'm asking.
It was approved last meeting.
Yeah.
Okay. And it's in his hands?
Yeah.
When do we expect to go live? Do you have any idea?
They said it's 90 days or something before they could have it be. We didn't go with that meter feeder guy. He didn't want to budge. He went with another company.
And I don't want to make it, it's not, I'm just trying to get an idea where the relationship is with the council and the parking authority.
We work for
and
them.
And how they work together and communicate together. Because I know my business has suffered, LaBella Beans has suffered, Armstrong's has suffered, all right? Last Tuesday at noontime, I walked the lot. I don't know if Pat came down and walked the lot with me that day or I saw him and we walked the lot. That lot was packed. My restaurant at noon was empty. LaBella Bean had five or six people, not empty, maybe three or four people, half a dozen. LaBella Bean had not even a half a dozen people. There was nobody in Armstrong's.
I walked around because of the beauty salon, wherever that is. There's nobody in there. And actually, they're closed on Tuesday, and I think they open at noon or open a little bit later on Tuesday. One of the challenges or question that I had that I asked Joe is, where are all these cars coming from and where are they going? And if they're there for extended periods of time. The first two rows of that lot, they had not one spot in it. And in the back section of the lot, I think I counted maybe, I don't know how many is there. I would guess if this number is correct, 115 parking spaces in lot two, there may have been 20, 25 spaces that were open at noon. And I'm not saying there wasn't any spaces, but I'd be curious where all those cars were at. Were people parking there and leaving and going somewhere else?
How would they pay? If they're there all day, how would they pay?
Well, I believe the pay stations will allow them to pay for up to 6 o'clock regardless of what time they start, is that correct? So they could pay from 9 o'clock till 6 o'clock if they wanted to.
And what do they pay an hour to park there?
It's 75 cents an hour. All right. And not about myself, I understand the 75 cents an hour. But the challenge was people couldn't pay. And then they went to the other option. Now they're standing out there in the rain. Standing there, got 3, 4, 5 people in a row. That's where the app was going to be very, very important if we could have got something in there pretty quickly. Again, I'm not here to talk about the parking authority meeting. I just trying to get their understanding of where the council is. Was the council involved in the 25 cents to 75 cents an hour increase? Was the council aware of the significant increase in the revenue that the parking authority has generated? From September through September of 2016, compared to September 2015, the parking authority revenue was up 52%. And they went the 25 cents to 75 cents an hour went into effect at the end of August of 2015. So over the comparative 12-month period, they saw a significant increase in revenue. And I'm not sure if, if that stuff was all aware of the people in the council that are responsible for the borough. The pay stations, like I said, we don't dislike them. It's just, is there another answer? But can it be more efficient?
If I could interject, because you asked them, and I'm sorry, just the dynamics of
the relationship.
The relationship is we're not the authority. It's a separate governing body. It's an independent authority, just like a sewer authority. A parking authority is a, there's appointments made by council that are staggered over time. But that once it's created, that parking authority, to remove it from the political body, that's why they exist historically. But that's a separate authority, just like this. So what role did this council have in approving the increase? Not, because it's not this board.
But you were aware of it though, right?
Just like they were aware of it. So your authority said it's great, but they don't have any power over They they've lit their feelings, just like you go to the meetings, and I think this council has sent emissaries of late to them to lit their feelings. No, but just so folks appreciate, it's a different governing unit that this council doesn't have direct power over.
Okay, so they have autonomy to do what they need, what they feel is necessary to effectively provide the parking services, maintain it, pay for it, and everything in Bridgeville.
Yes.
They just don't want us to come and ask for money.
Who's that? The council.
We don't give them any money.
And they don't give you
and money. They don't give us any money.
And if you have a fledgling authority, I'll bet you flip back in time, there may have been funding that helped generate these, but a mature authority, and the mayor may not have, is supposed to be designed to be self-perpetuating.
Okay. Right. That's my reason here tonight, to find out where that relationship resides. What were you aware of? We're 18 months into this significant price change from 25 cents to 75 cents. Is the borough aware of all these?
I'd say we're lateral partners on the flow chart of power on local government.
Okay. Yeah.
All right.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, Mike.
There's a couple of. This is the right time, right?
Yes.
Just
to
motion to adjourn. Now, is this old business or new business?
Well, it's actually new. This afternoon I found out that
that problem you have when you try and push your license plate number into the kiosk, it's called parallax error. It comes when you've got things that you look the distance of and that don't line up. It's rather interesting. And it's part of the fact that the glass is far away from the screen itself. I think that was pointed out. Part of the construction, it is what it is. The kiosks that we've got are the kiosks we've got at this point, okay? The problem that was pointed out 2 years ago of not taking credit cards, the problem that has been pointed out is with the hassle, the inconvenience of standing in front of a parking kiosk to pay for an hour or 2 hours of time. It's the hassle. You don't want to be bothered with it. It isn't the quarter, it isn't the 50 cents, it isn't the price. It is having to stand in the rain and figure out how to push the button or get the app or deal with this. The very people we're looking to get into our community, the customers of our restaurants, of our small businesses, the parking authority, we spend roughly $60,000 a year to bother. We do that by having people run around and issue $7 parking tickets. We do that by forcing them to pay for every minute of parking that they get. Now, our competition, which is not the city of Pittsburgh or even Carnegie, our competition in South Fayette and Collier Township doesn't have to deal with that. We are pushing and we are strangling the businesses that we want to have here. It is being done slowly. They're not going to leave tomorrow. They're just going to continue to squeeze and spiral down. The parking authority is trying. It is doing the best it can. You know, the people are trying that, but they don't have a connection to the businesses that are getting squeezed. You asked about governance. That's where council comes in. We have a connection to the people of the community. The idea of letting short-term parkers not have to go through that hassle is a solution. I look forward to the parking authority's next meeting and to them providing how to implement that solution, because it really does solve the problem from our community, as Mary pointed out. Mm-hmm.
Thank you, Mayor.
You're welcome.
Borough Manager, what are your comments?
I provided a report. If anybody has any questions for me, I'd be glad to.
Anybody have any for old business? Anybody have any for new business?
Bruce, I have a few things.
No, Mayor first. He already discussed.
Oh, all right. Well, first of all, Chief Chilio, I want to make sure that this is getting out there. We have received the donation flyer to the fire department. I know that that is something that they're always in need of our community supporting the fire department. So if just please pass out that think about even $20 or whatever it is, please think about donating to the fire department. They're a good group and they really need to do a lot for the community, and we need to be reciprocal. Also, the BA wants to thank you for hosting their bingo. The BA also asked me that any businesses in the community, they're still looking for team sponsors as well as their advertising signs as 3x4 foot signs. I think the VA just liked that I was on council now, so I could just every time on Sunday night, here, could you say this? And last but not least, on Thursday, the 16th at Neblewood, the Southwest Chamber is having their municipal luncheon, municipal manager luncheon. and Lori will be answering all kinds of questions to yours truly as the emcee of the event. So please, if anybody's available, it's a very, very important, if you want to know what's going on around the community with the different townships that the chamber resides, it's a great, great function. Just call the chamber to make a reservation. They need those rather quickly to save a spot. But definitely, it's a very informative event that I would suggest going to. I'm done, finally.
I got one thing to add with what she's got going on. And I forgot to bring this up in my report. The people that came down last Saturday for the spaghetti dinner for the Mount Lebanon fireman who's in his 20s fighting cancer, they thank everybody that came down and supported it. It was better than they thought for what's going on. He's 20 years old trying to have a wedding and using his wedding money right now to survive. So it was a huge success, and everybody in Bridgeville that did show up, they thank. That's it.
Anybody else?
Where do we stand with...
We're sitting.
Well, where do we sit? Where do we sit with regards to the zoning on the medical marijuana? What's going on with that?
We don't. There's no ordinance, there's no application in front of us.
Nobody's asked for anything?
We've had requests for zoning, information, certifications, but we've had no applications or other than that.
Have we responded to the requests for zoning certifications?
We have one in progress.
And will we be getting that out before the due date for their applications with the state?
I assume we will.
Good. That's all I have.
Motion to adjourn?
I just want to make a quick comment. Somebody was speaking about out-of-town landlords and I guess some of the horrible conditions of some of the properties in town. Back in my last regime, Mary and I tried to get a maintenance ordinance through that got shot down in flames. So I feel bad for the people who have to deal with out-of-town landlords. Mm-hmm. If we can't have a maintenance ordinance for rental property for everybody, Bridgeville owners and out-of-towners, there's no use even complaining to us. I mean, we can send the police in if it's a necessity. I mean, we've had gas leaks and torn up sidewalks, and we don't have any codes, so.
And we do now have them on. I mean, for our international property maintenance study, it has all the teeth that we need to enforce.
How long ago did that come in?
They've been since 2001.
Our version is 2009.
Right, but you're dealing with now.
We can't go into the properties to inspect them.
No.
That's something different.
Yeah, now you can, and I can get you some examples of what we've recently done elsewhere and recently had them upheld to challenge rental registration ordinances that require landlords to go through a modest, whether it's triennial in one community where I have it, where they go through a registration that serves many purposes for your,
well, that's what we
for your government, and they would go through even a property maintenance.
I asked Lori, and she sent out to all the surrounding, most of the municipalities in Allegheny County. They sent a stack of ordinances this way. There's not too many townships for us that don't have an ordinance.
Right. We actually had a draft ordinance regarding
your registration.
We have tenant registration already, and they have to register in April and November. But we don't have anything regarding any type of inspections,
How about actually registering like your place as a rental unit?
Yes.
And being required to do that on an annual basis.
Well, the tenant registration does that. But we don't have anything. We get calls from tenants that live in conditions that are unsafe, that are hard for us to go into the property to inspect because we don't have the approval of the landlord.
You can go into somebody's residence if the tenant's consent. Anywhere the tenant's live, they can consent for you to go.
For
for this action.
Wait, could you repeat that a little louder, please?
A tenant can certainly invite a code officer into the tenant's abode to look at where they live, and anywhere that they can go in that building, they can bring a code officer.
That's good news.
Now, is he okay to act as a code officer?
The code officer is able to act on anything that he or she sees where they observe it in a place where they were lawfully entitled to be.
So, I have a question. So you have a landowner who owns the property, who is not caring for that property, whether it's the grass, whether it's the weeds, whether it's dead trees. Are you saying now that the borough has the permission to either make them do it, or we do it and they pay for it? Explain.
Well, you're asking three different questions. Lori actually chases and it does a good job of going after the grass and the weed violators.
We also, if we can't get the property owners to do it, or if they're absentee landlords, we have an ordinance in place now that states that I send Public Works or I send a company onto the property, and then those charges are passed on to the property owner. And normally we get our monies because we take them to the magistrate.
Okay.
So we do that. But we have not in the past. Our code enforcement officer, you're going to have to talk to him because he is not, does not feel comfortable going into properties that he does not have the consent of the property owner. So that's going to have to be something that we talk to.
Yeah, and we've had things we needed to discuss and get clarification to him before.
Right, right, because if the property owner lets us in, or if we're called for, say, a water leak or that type thing, which is what happened at a property in Terrace Street, and then we found the home to be uninhabitable, the fire department was there, the police department were there, and then they called us, so.
Yeah, there's two things we can do. Lori and I can talk to the code officer and let them know what the extent of their rights and obligations are under the Fourth Amendment. Secondly, I can get you some samples that dovetail the tenant registration ordinance that you already have. There are ordinances which, and again, it's not going over the caucus scope and kind of overly intrusive, but maybe once every 3 years you do a triennial and you can kind of hit your whole borough. If you split it up and frankly the size of your borough, maybe you can do it 1 year, 2 year, 3 year. You can kind of have a program where all the landlords know, A, they have to ollie in free and register themselves every year, and then two, they will be on a kind of periodic basis subject to a general walkthrough, at least a cursory inspection by the code officer to make sure the basic health, welfare, safety features in the building are in place. And you don't need individualized probable cause to do those sorts of periodic inspections. To do inspections where it's an individual complaint or an individual issue, yes, you do. And you and I can talk to the code officer about circumstances under which they're allowed to go into a tenant's.
Mm-hmm. Now, if it's a dead tree, he doesn't really need permission to go on to the property, correct? Because he can see it.
Well,
right across the street, even, right?
Sometimes, yeah, and that's a different. You're picking on your favorite enforcement caucus, the tree.
Yeah.
For trees.
Because it could be my house that tree lands on.
Trees are
funny
issues sometimes. Sometimes they don't even come. The government's problem, if they're truly kind of an imminent danger of falling, then a code officer can cite on it. Otherwise, that's a private property issue between the two neighboring property owners as to whether you can force somebody to cut a tree down or what happens when it falls, who's liable for it, and all that kind of stuff.
I have a couple dead trees,
mm-hmm.
Enforcement letters out right now,
mm-hmm.
That the trees are totally dead, but if they're not, and they're just a nuisance, because we have trees that are nuisances that scratch other people's houses, that leaves come down and they're in their
down spots of those type things, then that's between the property owners.
These are fine trees with no needles.
Mm-hmm.
None. Zip.
None. Maybe go down.
And just to let you know.
Any other things, I'm sorry.
These are pine trees that are really high, and the neighbors that live in their property, they have little fire pits in the summer. That's fire hazard. And the trees are so high that they could fall in any of our houses, because it's.
Fire hazard, only if it's underneath the tree. If it's 10 feet away, they meet the compliance, but it is yours.
But the wind blows.
I.
The wind's blowing.
That's how the ordinance is written.
Yep.
I mean, I'm the one that comes out with the police to enforce it.
Yep.
We look at them case by case, as far as that.
The other thing to remind folks is that, you know, we have these right to know laws where people can seek information from. The one thing folks should know is that complaints, that you don't have to worry that your neighbor is gonna write us a note saying, tell me who told on me, who narked on me. We don't have to, under the law, where we protect, because you don't want that. You want that protection. So the complaints that you make, we talk about individual cases in public, and we encourage folks to make anonymous complaints through Lori's office. A, something to be done about it, and B, that you don't feel, you know, at risk of retribution or whatever for doing so.
And if you think the tree's dead, because I send a lot of notifications regarding those, so if you think it's dead, then I can do something, so just let me know.
Okay. Motion to adjourn.
Real quick, under your thing that Joe brought up, and I know Tom was talking about, you know, what it sounds like, some people are thinking about this, and we went through this before. There's a lot of renters' property in this town that people do take care of, but there is a decent amount that aren't. And under the firing, and I'm sure under the police and EMS isn't here, there's a lot of houses we go into that we see that are very bad. You know, we're trying not to pick on the ones that do the job right, but we do want to make it safe. And one incident, a small, quick incident we had, was an incident on Bridgeville Road of a fire, and somebody, yeah.
And I can tell you, Chief, that chiming in on another community that I represent, a few years ago when they brought in the heightened landlord tenant rules, registration, inspection rules on that, it was actually the good landlords that were the biggest proponents of it, because the bad landlords were bringing them down.
Yes.
Last time was totally awesome.
So I know, the natural reaction, you, a lot of times you get a knee-jerk, you know, reaction from the business landlord community, you're, you know, over-regulating this, doing all this stuff. I can tell you, a number of communities, and not one in particular, out on TV, but you know, that they were more, the good landlords overwhelmed the bad landlords. They're bringing down the value of their total. If you bring down the value of the total building stock, you bring down their rent. You bring down the value of their rent.
I mean, I think that's what stopped it last time was, I sat in this room and it was all good landlords.
Mm-hmm.
And you were all pitching too.
And none of them wanted it, and they were demanding the council not do it, and I think that's when it died. And
you might have
so
a different mindset. I'll give it to you. I'll circulate. You can take a look at what you want to do. And as far as you know, one community, it's, you know, I think it's $50.
The our building inspector, they do these in many towns. Some of it, that's all they do. Like in McKee's Rock, that's all they do. They do the inspection. They charge $45 to do an inspection. So, you know, for us, it would be just the cost of $45 that they would charge us.
Which gets passed on. Which you can pass that on in the application fee process, so it's neutral. You're not allowed to make money on like a hidden tax.
Right.
Just watch what you've done. $45 here, $50 there, $45,
$50. Well,
okay? They all add up.
Well,
to the good landlords, to the good landlords. Meanwhile, what you have them next to are not necessarily just bad landlords, but bad property owners. The conversation needs to be about property ownership and taking responsibility for your property.
whether you lease it to someone or whether you live in it yourself. Being responsible for your own property, picking up things when there's debris in your front yard, cutting your grass. You know, you ask, what can you do for your community? Keep your yard nice.
Well, clean up. That's why you have rules, man.
Yes, and we have lots of rules. We have lots of rules. We have the International Building Maintenance Standards. Our attorney has now explained that if a tenant finds that his landlord isn't doing the job, that the tenant can bring him in all the way inside the house and solve this problem.
To areas where the tenant
is permitted to go, correct? Okay, did I?
Is the tenant protected from any repercussions from the landlord?
Good question.
Our code officer works for us.
Doesn't even need to tell the landlord.
That depends, and I don't want to have our code officer getting Fourth Amendment lessons through, commentary in a public meeting.
Correct. We'll talk to the code enforcement officer directly about his ability to inspect and do things that need to keep the standard. But it is as much property owners, people that own and live within their own property,
It's both.
And to cause all of us to have to pay $50 to be inspected when we can just take care of the people who are not doing the job.
Pat, people that are renting out properties, it's a business.
Yes, it is. It's a business expense. That's correct.
If I want to burn my wife and kids down, it's on me. I'm not a business. We're trying to survive as a family and live. And I take care of my place. I think most people with families take care of their places.
Yes.
The people are renting out apartments to other people, making income. Mm-hmm. They should keep the damn place up.
That's all I got to say. And the tenants that live there have every right to petition their government for a redress of that grievance and have it solved.
They're not going to do that, Pat. They don't care.
Who? No.
The tenant that's living there.
The tenant that's living there?
Yeah.
And in all fairness, I will tell you that whatever rights a tenant has to, it allows them to be into their abode. And you have especially a building that has, it's one thing if you live in a 50-unit building, you can have anonymity. If you live in a duplex or a 4-unit building, you're not very anonymous, whether you call our anonymous hotline or not, Pat. So part of the reason why, Mr. Mayor, I'm sorry, part of the reason why you have some of those programs is partially for that reason, and partially for, and in the one community where I have it, it wasn't a blighted community. Some communities have it because they're on blight or they're on the verge or they don't want to get there. Other communities are very well ill and decide they don't want to. We're going to fix a sore throat. We're not waiting to get cancer with the housing stock, basically.
And that's what we have.
They took, and the program ran at about $1.38 per month per unit for a landlord.
And
that's a policy decision. I can just get you the documents and you guys can.
We've seen lots of those standards, Tom. So.
Okay, motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Joe, second. Thank you. Thank you, audience.